Hello friends, welcome to An Academy. Let's crack the PG. I'm Dr. Shonali Chandra, and in this video I will be speaking about congenital cytomegalovirus infection. I have highlighted my reference code here, that is SHONALI. So if you take a plus subscription, you can use this code to avail a 10% discount on your subscription package. An Academy is India's largest learning platform. If you get a plus subscription, you get access to unlimited live and recorded courses from India's best educators. You'll get daily live classes where you can chat with your educator, you know, engage in a doubt clearing session, ask your doubts, queries, get them clear there and there. So it's like a live classroom experience. The courses are structured keeping in line with the latest NEET-PG syllabus. There are also live tests and quizzes which will help you evaluate your performance as you go along. And most importantly, one subscription gives you unlimited access, so you can watch all of the live sessions from all of the faculties who are active on the platform. And even if you miss out on the live sessions, you can always go back and watch the recorded versions from the comfort of your own devices. So top educators are associated with the platform, like Dr. Nikita Nanwani, Dr. Mohammad Azam, Dr. Preeti Sharma, Dr. Devesh Mishra, sir, for pathology. And all 19 subjects which we need to prepare for our post-grad entrance examination, they are covered on the platform. And apart from that, every now and then, comprehensive batch courses and even short duration crash courses, they keep getting launched. So you can check out the ongoing courses in the platform as well. And as far as the subscription packages go, you can take one depending upon your need and requirement. So those of you who want a crash course, those of you who are targeting the upcoming exams can take the 3 months or 6 months subscription. And for those of you who are targeting the next mid-year exams, you can take the 12-month subscription because it will give you ample time to go through all of the sessions. We'll leave you also enough time in the end to revise. It turns out to be more economical also in the longer run. And for those of you who want a slower pace of preparation, you're in your third year or final year MBBS and you started reading up, you started preparing, and of course you're juggling hospital duties and clinics and classes and schedules all at the same time, so you can take the 24-month subscription. It turns out to be far more economical also in the longer run. And if you subscribe using my code, that is SHONALI, then you can avail a 10% discount on whatever subscription package that you choose from. So coming back to the session where I am going to take up maternal and fetal infections one by one, and that's a special request, so I'm going by it. And to begin with, I'm going to talk about the cytomegalovirus infection, and I've chosen this to begin with because it's the most common infection. We're going to see how it infects the mother and how it leads to infection in the fetus. So let's talk about what cytomegalovirus is. Let's just revise a little bit of microbiology here. So cytomegalovirus is belonging to the DNA herpes virus family group. So it's a double-stranded virus. And like all DNA herpes viruses, this also is shared by the cytomegalovirus, is that it becomes latent in the mononuclear phagocyte. So latent infection also happens with cytomegalovirus, and once it becomes latent, it can get reactivated in the future whenever the immunity of the individual dwindles. So I'm talking about what individuals? I'm talking about all these individuals standing in the background, you, me, everybody else around you, children, adults alike. So it's a very ubiquitous organism. It's an infection which is mostly asymptomatic. All right. And, you know, if I would contract a cytomegalovirus infection or you would contract one, there's quite a possibility that we wouldn't even know, or we would just have a mild flu-like illness and it would just last for a couple of days and go away. So we might not even know that we have contracted the virus and gotten over it, and then it has gotten latent in our mononuclear phagocytic system and waiting for reactivation to take place. But yes, for you and me, it's not a problem because it's just a mild flu-like illness, mostly asymptomatic. And you would ask this question that if I get cytomegalovirus once, is it like that I will not get it again? So it's not like chickenpox, where you once have chickenpox, then you don't have the same chickenpox again. But here, the immunity that is acquired with one-time infection of cytomegalovirus, that immunity is not sufficient, that immunity is partial. So reinfection can also occur. But yes, for you, me, for everybody else around, it's not a problem, but it for the fetus, it is. So we'll talk about that in a bit here. What I want to say is, how does it spread in the community? The next question is, how does it spread? So it spreads by person-to-person contact, close contact, like any other viral illness. And yes, cytomegalovirus is excreted in all the body fluids. You think of the fluid, it's there, right? So it's there in the saliva, it's there in the nasopharyngeal secretions, it's there in the lung secretions, it is there in the bloodstream, urine, cervical secretions. So this virus is excreted in all body fluids, and contact with any of these body fluids can lead to its spread. So person to person close contact is required, so it can spread by activities like sneezing and coughing and kissing and, you know, sharing the same straw while drinking, sharing the fluid in the same plate, or fomites or infected hands. So this is how this virus spreads, right? But yes, most of us will have no problem with it. The problem is in the fetus. Cytomegalovirus is the most common perinatal infection. You and me, we get infected with cytomegalovirus, no problem. If the fetus gets infected with cytomegalovirus, then that's a problem. To show you how common it is, let's have a look at the incidence. The incidence of congenital CMV is about 0.5%. It's about 1 in 200 live births are identified with having congenital CMV infection. The good thing is that about 80% of these are going to have no problem. 80% are going to be absolutely normal, no problem. In the remaining 20%, that means out of all these, out of the affected ones, out of the infected ones, about 1 in 5, that's about 20%, are going to have sequelae of CMV infection. Okay, now how does this perinatal infection occur? So you get infected, a boy gets infected, an adult male gets infected, I get infected, a non-person gets infected, no problem. But if a pregnant woman gets affected, then that can lead to spread of the infection to the fetus. So most common transmission which is seen to the fetus happens by vertical transmission through the placenta. So there is placental transmission, vertical transmission across the placenta is the most common mode of spread to the fetus. And yes, the other body secretions are also carrying the virus. So yes, during delivery from an infected birth canal also the virus can spread. During breastfeeding also the virus can spread from the infected mother to the newborn, right? But most commonly it spread occurs by vertical transmission in utero through across the placenta. Let's focus more on this vertical transmission. Okay, let's focus a little bit more on this vertical transmission. The risk of this vertical transmission increases in the later part of pregnancy when the placental barrier is much thinned out. So yes, the maximum risk of transmitting the virus from an infected mother to a fetus is in the third trimester. That's when the vertical transmission risk is maximum, right? But if in case the infection or the vertical transmission happens in the first trimester, the earlier the vertical transmission happens, the more severe the manifestations of the fetus. So that's again a very, very important point to note, that the fetus is more severely affected if infection occurs less than 20 weeks of gestation. If infection of the mother occurs at less than 20 weeks of gestation, especially most severe if it occurs in the first trimester. So a mother who has contracted cytomegalovirus infection and she's in the first trimester, the vertical transmission risk might not be maximum, but if at all it happens, then this fetus will be more severely affected because organogenesis and most of the development of the brain is happening in this first trimester, and this virus has a particular predilection for affecting the neurons and the growing nerve cells and the growing brain. So that's why the effects which happen to the fetus, or more commonly effects on the brain, effects on the developing brain of the fetus. There can be microcephaly, a smaller sized head. Microcephaly is seen. Chorioretinitis, infection of the eyes, infection of there. Chorioretinitis can happen. In fact, this is an ultrasound image showing the transverse section of the brain, and you can see that there are periventricular calcifications. These are the ventricles here, and around the ventricles, calcific areas, white areas can be seen. So periventricular calcifications occur. There can be fetal growth restriction, and yes, a newborn can also suffer from all these congenital CMV-like manifestations. You can see that the baby is slightly yellow, so there's jaundice here, hepatosplenomegaly, because of underlying hemolysis that predisposes to hepatosplenomegaly, and you can see these petechial hemorrhages. And what we call it also sometimes, we call it as a blueberry rash. We sometimes call it as a blueberry rash, blueberry muffin rash. You've seen a blueberry muffin? Okay, so blueberry muffin has those purplish dots, blueberry dots on top of it. So these are the purplish dots, the petechial hemorrhages, giving this rash a characteristic name, which is called as the blueberry muffin rash. So these are the manifestations of congenital CMV infection. They can be very varied. You can remember them. It is in the name itself, CMV. So you can remember M, microcephaly. You can remember V, you can remember ventricle. So very characteristic trait of CMV is ventricular, periventricular calcification. You can remember C for calcifications, right? So these are important features that you need to remember about this CMV virus infection in the perinatal period. Now, the other important aspect is that these are the acute events, but yes, CMV can also lead to long-term sequelae. There can be long-term sequelae of congenital CMV infection, like mental retardation, like motor and sensory deficits in the child, and vision loss. This chorioretinitis will lead to long-term vision loss. Sensory neural hearing loss can happen, right? In fact, CMV is considered as the most common infective cause of mental retardation in childhood. Most common infective cause is CMV. In fact, CMV is also considered as the most common infective cause of sensory neural hearing loss in childhood. So these are the long-term sequelae which can happen with congenital CMV infection. And like I told you, that most commonly it spreads by vertical transmission from the mother to the baby across the placenta. The maximum risk of the transmission is in the third trimester, but if the transmission were to take place in the first trimester especially, it is going to be more severe infection. So the next question that arises is that when can a mother transmit the infection to the fetus? What I want to say is many people have this doubt. Right now, a non-pregnant woman could be having CMV infection. Does that mean that when she gets pregnant in the future, she can transmit the infection to the fetus? No. So please keep in mind that an infection that affects a woman maybe months, maybe years ago will not lead to infection of the fetus. So past infection months and years ago does not infect the fetus. Infection to the fetus can happen when the mother gets infected during pregnancy, very, very important, and especially also if she conceives within 6 months of primary infection. Now, that's a very catchy statement that I'm making. What am I saying? I'm saying that if today a woman were to contract a CMV infection and she gets pregnant within the next 6 months, especially within the next month itself, then still she herself has gotten over the infection, but she can still transmit the infection to the fetus if she conceives within 6 months of primary infection. So the emphasis on primary. Because there can be a primary infection, infection for the first time, or there can be a recurrent infection which comprises a non-primary infection, could be a reinfection or a reactivation, both clubbed together as recurrent infection. So they often ask you this question in MCQ in the exams, that where is the risk of fetal infection more? The risk of fetal infection is more with a primary infection as compared to a recurrent infection. So keep that in mind also, that it is the primary infection in which the risk of fetal infection is more. Now the next important aspect is, if I'm a woman who's wanting to conceive, who's planning on a pregnancy, I don't know if I've had a CMV, I don't know when will I acquire a CMV, I don't know if I could even transmit it to the fetus if I conceive within 6 months of the primary infection. So the whole purpose of preventing the infection in the mother resides with following usual precautionary measures. The focus is on prevention of CMV infection in the mother. Why? Because unfortunately, once a person gets infected, once a fetus gets infected, there is no treatment for this infection. There is no drug treatment for this infection as of now. The other important thing to note here is that there is no vaccine. So if you think that, is it possible that I can get myself vaccinated, like I get myself vaccinated for influenza or any other flu, then there is no vaccine also available for CMV infection. So there's no vaccine, there's no treatment. So the major focus of preventing congenital CMV, the main focus is on prevention of CMV infection in a pregnant woman, right? Now, how can a pregnant woman acquire this infection? A pregnant woman is very likely, most likely, to acquire this infection from her young children. So if there's a pregnant woman who has small toddlers and young children, or she's paying visits to the daycare center, or she works in an environment where she's exposed to a lot of young children, she is at risk of acquiring CMV infection. So how does she go about protecting herself? By following the usual protocol of safe hygienic practices, right? So what is advised to these pregnant women is that one should take usual precautions, like do not kiss young children on the lips or the mouth. You know, if you want to shower love and praises onto them, you can do so by maybe hugging slightly and kissing on the forehead rather than kissing on the mouth. Safely washing your hands and sanitizing, and do not share food and utensils, and take care precaution of sanitizing the bottles or the used products of the toddlers, right? So these are the kind of precautions which are advised to pregnant women to avoid contracting CMV infection. So safe disposable of diapers, and that is one thing that is also advised. And every time, safe hygienic procedures will go a long way for prevention of CMV infection in the pregnant woman. So these are the usual measures which we adopt. But yes, you can also ask the question that how do we identify CMV infection antenatally, and what can be done for that? So there are two possible situations when we will find ourselves identifying CMV infection in the antenatal period. One is when we can have a ultrasound suspicion of congenital CMV infection. Okay, the woman could come up with an ultrasound report in the second trimester with features suggestive of a congenital CMV infection, suspicious features, or we find a pregnant woman with a mononucleosis like illness, a flu-like illness, and then we might suspect, oh my god, she might have cytomegalovirus infection. So in those situations, we go for a serological testing where we can check for the IgM and the IgG levels. And important to note here is that we cannot use IgM alone. We can't use IgM levels alone, because IgM antibodies against the CMV virus, they can persist for long durations of time. So normally in acute infections, IgM levels rise rise and then they disappear once the infection ceases. But IgM levels in CMV infection can persist for a long duration of time, for years in fact. So that's why we can't rely on IgM level alone, and we'll have to go ahead and do the IgG levels as well. And what will help us to make a distinction is the IgG avidity test. Avidity test determines how avidly or how tightly these antibodies bind, right? So IgD avidity testing could be done. If we find that the IgM is positive, the IgG is also positive, and it has low avidity, the IgG avidity is that of low avidity, then it means it's a primary CMV infection. Okay, so in an acute primary CMV infection, the IgG antibodies that are formed, they are still immature, they have low avidity. So primary CMV infection can be identified there, and if primary CMV infection is identified, then to test for the CMV infection in the fetus, one will have to go for invasive fetal testing. And if the IgM is positive and the IgG is also positive, but it has high avidity, that means it's a recurrent CMV infection, and we know that the risk of transmitting to the fetus is very low in recurrent CMV infection. So instead of invasive testing, we can just go for a routine ultrasound follow-up as well, right? And then I have seen sometimes, you know, women come up with the torch report in hand in the OPDs, you know, and then they are worried, oh, this infection is showing positive, it's highlighted here, what does that mean and everything. So let me tell you that if the IgM is negative and the IgG is positive with high avidity, that means that it's a latent infection. That means the infection is at least 6 months old. So there is no risk. So one need not be scared of seeing a report with IgG positive on CMV. And if it's high avidity, if the IgM is negative, you can be assured that there is no risk, right? So that means it's a latent infection, it's at least 6 months old. So one can be assured in those circumstances, right? So this is about CMV infection. And we will gear up for further infections one by one. I will keep posting them. So let's crack Neat PG. And you can subscribe to the platform and use my code SHONALI to get a 10% discount on your subscription package as well. Thank you so much. Goodbye.